chapters, but Psalms is not in chapters. As we know, it's in divisions. And I don't know if my battery is low here. If you can give me, turn up the master volume a little bit, if you can. Psalms is in divisions, and there's five divisions of Psalms. And of course, we're not going to go off into that right now, but whenever you hear people say Psalms chapter so-and-so, you know that they really don't understand the book of Psalms. I heard one preacher say Psalms had 150 chapters in it, but it doesn't have 150. These are not chapters. It's in divisions. And there's five divisions, and so if you have a good Bible, it would tell you what those divisions are. But if you don't, I'll give them to you. It's in five divisions, and the first division is Psalms 1 through 41. Psalms 1 through 41. So that means then that if you're going to read a psalm from Psalms 1 to 41, you would say the first division of psalm, and then you would give the number of the psalm. So if you're reading from Psalms 50, or Psalms, should I say, 30, then you would say the first division of Psalms, number 30. The second division is Psalms 42 to 72. That's the second division. So if you call any psalm to read between 42 and 72, you would say, I'm reading from the second division of Psalms, number 42. Or number 50, or number 70. That's the second division. So again, the first division is from 1 to 41. Second division is 42 to 72. Third division of Psalms is found from 73 to 89. That's the third division of Psalm. So any psalm that you read from there would be the third division of Psalms and whatever psalm you'd be reading from. Fourth division is from Psalms 90 to 106. That's the fourth division. And the fifth division is Psalms 107 to 150. So, and of course, we did some study on the book of Psalms, but we never did really complete it. And so maybe one day we will study and complete our study on the Psalms and then teach on the book of Psalms. There's a lot in it. All the Psalms were not written by David. You had some that were written by other writers, but it is a outstanding book, and just to give you that information on it, it's in five books or five divisions. Can we say amen? All right, so hopefully you have that. So we'll be reading from the first division of Psalms, number 9, verse number 7. All right, and if we have it, let's read it. But the Lord shall endure forever. He hath prepared his throne for judgment. Now, we taught this subject before, but it's been a while since we taught it. You read in the book of Revelation where it talks about, in Revelation chapter number 20, a white throne was set up, and we generally call it the great white throne of judgment. But when you deal with the Bible, we have to understand that the Bible is not like any other book. And a lot of times, because we are so familiar with certain things, that we read something in the Bible and we automatically assume that we are familiar with it because it sounds similar to what we as Westerners are accustomed to. But what we have to understand that the Bible is not like any other book. And a lot of times we think that we understand certain things because the Bible mentions certain things. Well, particularly the Bible is part natural and part spiritual. And because we assume that we understand the natural things of the Bible, which we can understand the natural things of the Bible, you can understand some of the natural things of the Bible, without even being filled with the Holy Ghost. But many people make the mistake that because they understand the natural things of the Bible, they automatically assume that they can understand the spiritual things. And nothing can be further from the truth. The only way to understand the spiritual things of the Bible is that you must have the Holy Ghost to open your eyes and lead you and guide you as you are searching through the scriptures. And even being taught the scriptures, you have to have the Spirit of God must be at work in order for us to even get an understanding. And so a lot of people make the mistake. They feel that they can understand the Bible by just reading it. And so many of them think that they can go out and get a different version that will supposedly make it easier for them to read. And all of these different versions do is just simply destroy many of the meanings of the scriptures to where they cause it to say what God never intended for it to say. Man cannot bring forth a certain kind of a translation of the Bible to cause you to be able to understand it just by reading it, because God has it set up to where you can't understand it by just reading it. It is spiritually discerned, which means that the only way you can understand the things of the Bible is if the Spirit of the Bible reveals it to you. Can we say amen? You know, and so this causes a lot of people to get themselves in trouble. And this is why we have so many misinterpretations and so many various different doctrines and false teachings being taught, because people think that they understand the Bible, but they really don't. Now, we have that incident here. When it talks about God's preparing his throne for judgment, he is not talking about some big chair that we are accustomed to when we think of a throne. Now, Solomon had a throne that was worth millions and millions of dollars. I think it was made of ivory overlaid with gold, and the chair alone was worth millions of dollars. And if you put it in monies of today, that chair probably would have been worth billions of dollars in today's currency. So when you think of a throne, you immediately think of a great, big, gigantic, beautiful chair with arms on it and so on and so forth. But the throne that God is preparing here in the scripture has to do with his church. His church is the throne. And of course, when you read in the book of Revelation about the great white throne, people immediately think that God has a great big white chair in heaven that he's sitting in. And nothing can be further from the truth. It's called a white throne because the saints are in their white robes that make up the throne. And it speaks of him sitting on his throne because he is in the midst of us in that throne. And so all of these things are symbolic language, but people think that just because they are accustomed to what a throne is, that they automatically assume that when the Bible talks about a throne, they know what that is. But here in Psalms number 9, verse 7, God has prepared his throne for judgment. Now, this, of course, is a prophecy, because the church is what makes up his throne. And he is preparing us now for that day. The Bible talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 that the saints shall judge the world. Now, in order for us to get to that point, God has to prepare us for it. And so, but the fact that he mentions here that he hath prepared his throne for judgment lets you know that God is working on his throne right now. Or he's working on his people right now, or he's working on his church. He is preparing us for that day. Everything we encounter in this saved life is to prepare us for the day of judgment, for the day that God will use us to execute judgment upon the nations of the world, the people of the world. We are learning about him right now. We're learning about his ways, his thoughts, his will, and his character. He is working on us right now. He is preparing us to use us in judgment. He is working on his throne, his church. Now, that's why we go through the things that we go through. That's why he has allowed us to judge ourselves now. so that we will be adequately prepared when the rapture takes place and when the time comes for judgment of the world, the end of the sixth day, we will be prepared and qualified to execute upon them the judgment that is written, as the Bible says in Psalms 149. So the scripture here says, the Lord shall endure forever. He's from everlasting to everlasting. He hath prepared his throne for judgment. And his throne is simply the church. Now let's look at the scripture and prove it to you. Let's go to Psalms 45. This would be the second division of Psalms 45 and verse number 6. All right. Verse number 6, let's read. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Now, this is a prophecy concerning Jesus Christ. And it is God speaking in that body called Jesus, saying, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. The scepter of thy kingdom is a right scepter. Because you read this in Hebrews. And I don't know if we're going to read that. Well, let's go to Hebrews. Let's jump over and go to Hebrews chapter number 1. And we will come back to this and show you how this was a prophecy that was fulfilled. Hebrews chapter number 1. This was God speaking while he was in his body concerning himself in that body. And this is, of course, a scripture that the Trinitarians like to try to use to say that there is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. And they like to use this scripture to make that point. Well, let us go to Hebrews chapter number 1, and we will read verse number 8 and 9. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8 and 9. All right. Well, let's read it. But unto the Son he saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. Hold it right there. And this is what the Trinitarians like to use. They say, you see, the Son is a God. The Father is God. Son is God. The Holy Ghost is God. All divine, all co-substantial, all equal, and so on and so forth. But there is no God the Son. The Son was that body. Well, what does this scripture here mean then? But unto the Son he said, thy throne, O God. Now, we read it in the Psalms more than 1,000 years before Jesus actually came. 1,000 years before God actually got in that body and called that body his son. Before that happened, before Mary gave birth to the body of Jesus, the Son of God, and before God got inside of that body while it was yet in its mother's womb, God spoke concerning himself in that body about himself, saying, but unto the Son he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and what? Ever. Now his throne here is simply the manifestation of his power. His authority is forever and ever because God is forever. All right? But unto the Son he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Verse 9, thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore, God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. Then his fellows would be the angels. So he has a position. The Son of God has a position that the angels could never have. The Son of God is of such that the angels could never be. And God spoke concerning himself in the office of the sonship, or in that body, about himself, calling himself God in that body. He wasn't calling the body God, but he was calling himself in that body. as God, because the body was human. The body was born, and God was never born. Can we say amen? So we just wanted to make that point. But however, the throne of God, as far as it being the church is concerned, is something he is preparing. Now, let us go to 97th Psalm, Psalms 97, and verse number 2. This would be the third division of Psalm, I believe. Number 97 and verse number 2. All right. And let's read. Clouds and darkness are round about him. Righteousness and judgment are the habitation of his throne. Now, when it comes to God's throne, or when it comes to his church is filled with righteousness and judgment. Righteousness and judgment are the habitation of his throne. And of course, we obtain the righteousness of God when we got saved. That's why Paul said in Romans chapter 1, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek, for therein is the righteousness of God. And, of course, in the gospel is contained the righteousness of God, and God has determined by saving us that we may be made, as Paul said in Ephesians, the righteousness of God in him. That's why holiness is important, because God's throne is his habitation. And his habitation would be filled with righteousness and what? Judgment or justice. Righteousness and judgment. And since the habitation of God's throne is righteousness and judgment, it means then that those that are in the throne, which would make up the throne, which is the church, will be a people of righteousness and judgment. Righteousness because of our salvation, and because we were successful in making the rapture and being made the righteousness of God in him, that the glorified church would reflect the righteousness of God. That his church would show forth his righteousness in a manner that could not be shown forth any other way. And that righteousness is not our righteousness, but it is whose righteousness? His righteousness. That's why holiness is so important. Because we, if we're going to be in the throne of God, we must be made the righteousness of God in him. We must be holy. We must exercise judgment. We must allow God to make us, to prepare us for that day. And that's why he's given us opportunity to judge ourselves. Paul said, so that we would not be condemned with who? The world. See, the reason why the world is going to be condemned is because they refuse to judge themselves. So God's got to judge them in the end. And he gives us an opportunity, because the Bible says judgment begins at the house of God. He gives us an opportunity to judge ourselves now, so that when the rapture takes place, we will be ready. There will be nothing in our lives that he would be against, or he will not be able to. He will be able to look at us and not find anything against us. We will be ready. We will be prepared. We will be what he has designed for us to be at that moment, and we will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. This is what God is trying to accomplish through us. That's why holiness is so important. That's why righteousness is important. That's why it's important for us to be doers of the word and not just what? Hearers only. Beholding in our face in the glass and immediately go walking off and forgetting what manner of man or woman we were. Deceiving ourselves. Does that make sense? Can we say amen? All right. So let us now go to Psalms 103 and verse 19. Psalms 103, verse 19. All right. Let's read. The Lord hath prepared his throne in what? The heavens. Now, of course, prepare indicates that he had to work on it. Now, if this is something other than the church, then what is it then? Because God's authority and power to judge, he don't have to work on that because that's what he is. Can you say amen? But the fact that he has to prepare indicates that it is something that is not ready or something that needs some working on. And he is working in you both to will and to do of his what? Good pleasure. So what God is preparing is he is preparing his church. Church is the most important thing to God. He loves the gates of Zion more than all the dwellings of Jacob. God's attention right now is on his son, his church, his bride, preparing us to use us to close out the sixth day in judging the world. So, he says, the Lord hath prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom does what? Ruleth over all. Now, of course, you might say, well, the Bible says heaven's there, Pastor. Well, the Bible says he's raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly what? Places. That's where? In the church. We're not out there in Mars somewhere, and he's preparing us. We say amen. It's right here on the earth. Yeah. So it speaks of him working on his church to get us ready for that day. Let's go to Isaiah chapter number 6 and verse number 1. Isaiah chapter 6, verse number 1. And let me see here. Well, we're going to read the whole thing. I just have verse number 1 over here. So I guess we will deal with the whole thing. Psalms, Isaiah chapter 6, verse number 1. All right. Let's read. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And I've heard so many preachers so many times say that Isaiah was the cousin of Uzziah, who was the king of Judah, I believe it was. And they say that because he was so close to Uzziah, his cousin, that he really couldn't see the Lord. And so God allowed Uzziah to die so that Isaiah can see him. And they like to say the reason why a lot of people can't see God as they need to see him is because they got so many Uzziahs in their place. That is not true at all. That's a misunderstanding of the scripture. Because they're trying to say that he could not see the Lord because his cousin was in the way. Well, you have a word there that contradicts that they seem to have overlooked. And that word is also. Also. You see, every word in the Bible is important. You have to pay attention to every word. You see, because it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord. The reason why also is there is to let us know that he saw the Lord before Uzziah died and he saw the Lord after Uzziah died. So that means then that Uzziah was not the problem. He was still seeing the Lord when he was alive and even after he died. You see how we can get so mixed up when we just look over words? Can we say amen? And I heard Bishop Paddock say, and it is true, and I don't mean to say that as a criticism, but it is a fact that saints are notorious poor readers. We read over words, we mispronounce words as we read them, we overlook words. Every word in the Bible is important. Now, if you don't believe me, I guess I'm going to be putting this person on the spot, whoever we call to read the scripture. Just pay attention when somebody reads the scripture out loud. Whether they read every word and pronounce every word properly. But it has been my experience in the last 35 years of being saved. It'll be 36 next month. That saints generally, not every saint, but in a general sense, we can be some very poor readers. when it comes to the Bible. But we have to pay attention to every word. He said, every word that proceedeth out of the what? Mouth of God. Well, so that's not true. And I've heard so many preachers say it over the last 35 years. It's not true. Uzziah was not in the way, because in the year that he died, he said, I also saw the Lord, which means he saw him before and Uzziah died, and he saw him after Uzziah died. And as we told you before, Isaiah prophesied for 66 years. His ministry lasted longer, I believe, than any other prophet. 66 years. He prophesied over a period of 66 years. And that's why his book is called the Mini Bible. But if you read all of Isaiah's prophecies in these 66 chapters, it'd only probably take you about an hour to read 66 years worth of prophecies. Isn't that something? Well, he said, I also saw the Lord sitting upon a what? Throne. Let's read. High and lifted up, and his train what? Fill the temple. That is the presence of God filled. So he is seeing this vision. God sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. The presence of God is anointed, is trained, is filled the temple. This is what he's seeing, this vision in heaven. All right, verse number 2. Above it stood the what? Seraphims. Each one had 6 wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he what? Did fly. Now the seraphims are symbolic of the church in heaven. And that's why he is sitting upon the throne, because the church is there. And the seraphims had 6 wings. Now you read in Ezekiel chapter number 1, where it talks about it having 4 wings. In Ezekiel chapter, I believe it's in Ezekiel chapter number 1, you read about the creatures there with 4 wings. Let me turn there right quick to point out the verse to you, so that you can read it in your spare time. It's in the first chapter of Ezekiel. We're not going to go there. And it's found in, get this Bible here going, because these pages are sticking together. In chapter 1, and it talks about the whirlwind coming out of the north. I'm in Lamentations there. Anyway, you can read about it in Ezekiel chapter 1. And it is found in verse number 5. Also out of the midst thereof came the likeness of 4 living creatures. And this was their appearance. They had the likeness of a man. And when you read there about the wings that they had 4 wings, which would mean that that is the church in the earth that the prophet Ezekiel was seeing. But here Isaiah sees the church in heaven called seraphims. Now, the Bible talks about we're going to be like angels. That's why it's called seraphims. This is the only place in your Bible where you see the word seraphim. And the seraphims are there with 6 wings. Now, angels do not have what? Wings. You know, you read about cherubims with wings. And you read about the seraphims with wings. But all of this is symbolic of the fact that the church is in heaven and that it is there glorified. All right? Because the 2 extra wings gave us the power to fly. And that power came to us when we made the rapture. Or when we will make the rapture. Can we say amen? We ain't made it yet. But when we make it. So they had 6 wings. With twain he covered his face. With twain he covered his feet. With twain he did fly. Verse number 3, and one cried unto another and said, what? Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is what? Full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with what? Smoke. That's the presence of God. Verse 5, then said I, Isaiah speaking now, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, talking about his people Israel. For mine eyes have seen the King, who? The Lord of hosts. And I believe it's in the 12th chapter of St. John, I think it is, somewhere around there, where the Lord speaks concerning the fact how Isaiah saw him in his glory. So Isaiah is seeing Jesus in heaven with the glorified church, actually 600 years before Jesus even came on the scene, or before God came in that human body. Isaiah is seeing him on the throne. And Jesus testified about the fact that Isaiah did see him. He said, "For mine eyes have seen" who? "The King," the what? "The Lord of hosts." Well, let's read on, verse number 6. "Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar, and he laid it upon my mouth and said, 'Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy" what? "Sin is purged." Now, how is iniquity and sin purged today? Through what? Plan of salvation. So this was a type of the plan of salvation that he experienced in his vision. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the what? Blood of Jesus. Now, when you go down in Jesus' name, there's not a whole bunch of bucket of blood that pours out of heaven. Is that right? Nor does the water turn to blood as the Catholics teach. But that's why we call the name, because the blood is in the name of what? Jesus. And God bears witness to the fact that he has washed away our sins when he fills us with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That is the Spirit bearing witness of the fact that God has accepted our faith and our repentance, and that's when we are born again. That's when our iniquity is taken away and our sin is purged. And this is what he experienced, type of the new birth in his vision. Verse number 8. "Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send and who will go for us?' Then said I, 'Here am I, send me.'" Verse 9. "And he said, 'Go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert and be" what? "Healed." Now, of course, Jesus prophesied about this. Well, this is prophesied by the Lord speaking here. And Jesus alluded to this, had reference to the Jews, of the fact that when he would come, because their eyes were closed and their ears were heavy, and their their ears heavy, shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their heart, and convert and be healed. He prophesied concerning the fact that their eyes would be shut and their ears closed. What is that? That when he would come as the Messiah, that they would not see him as the Messiah, but that if their eyes were open and if their ears were not heavy, they could see who he was and accepted him as a nation and be converted, and he would heal them. But he came in a manner to where they could not see, could not hear, that he would be rejected, that he would be crucified, that he would be rejected as a nation, that the nation of Israel would reject him, opening the door of salvation to the Gentiles. He had it all in his plan, and none of the apostles knew until Peter got the revelation 10 years after the day of Pentecost. And of course, the apostle Paul came on the scene, and God began to use him to extend salvation to the Gentiles. But all of this had to happen in order for them to reject him so that he could die for the sins of the world. Because if they had not rejected him, he would not have been able to die for the sins of the world and make salvation available for all of mankind. Well, he sent in Isaiah to them, verse 11. "Then said I, Lord, how long? And he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate, and the Lord have removed me far away, and there be a great forsaken in the midst of the land, but yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return and shall be eaten as a teal tree And as an oak whose substance is in them, when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. So in other words, he's saying, Lord, how long are their ears going to be heavy that they will not be able to hear? How long will their eyes be shut? Well, in essence, until their judgment is over, to the middle of the tribulation period. When he will come, when the Antichrist turns on them and he comes down from heaven and they will look at him and say, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him. Their eyes will become open. So how long will it be? Well, it will be throughout the church dispensation. It will be during the first part of the tribulation period before they get the revelation as to who Jesus really was, that he was their Messiah the whole time. That's how long it's going to be. All right, well, let's go to Matthew chapter 16, verse 17 through 19. He is preparing his throne. And that part of the throne, that throne he is preparing, is the church. The church is called his throne. All right. Matthew 16, verse 17 through 19. All right. And let's read. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed unto thee, my Father, which is in. Now, what did he have revealed to him? What was revealed to them? That who Jesus was, that he was their Messiah. They have gotten a revelation. He said, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Simon, Peter, you have gotten a revelation from God. And that's the only way that anybody can see who Jesus really is, has to be revealed to them. All right. Verse 18. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, they like to use this scripture and say that the church is built upon Peter because the name Peter means a stone. Well, he's not talking about that because he says upon this rock. This rock. What is the rock? The revelation as to who he was. The church is built upon the identity of who Jesus is. That's just how important. Because how are we going to be like him if we don't know who he is? Is that right? We have to know who he is in order to be like him. We have to have it revealed to us in order to be like him. Well, the church is built upon this rock. It's built upon the foundation of who Jesus is. That he is God manifest in flesh. God in the office of the sonship. That God took on a human body, called that body his son, and took on that human body for the purpose of being able to shed blood, for the purpose of being able to die for the sins of humanity, to extend salvation. He didn't send somebody else to do the job. He didn't send some little boy to do the job. He did the job himself. He just took on a human body and did it all by himself. Well, he said he's going to build his church upon the revelation of who he is, and the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against it. So God is building his church. God is only concerned with his throne, his church. That's why he's put judgment in the church. This is why we must practice judging ourselves now in light of the word of God. Because this is how he is preparing us. This is how he's building. He's building it with the souls of men. He is saving people all over, putting them in his church, preparing them so that the day will come, we will be the throne of God and him using us to judge the nations of the world. And we will be able to judge them because we would have shown them the righteousness of who? God. We have allowed the righteousness of God to shine through us to show the world. We would be showing the world Jesus, what God is like, who God is, what righteousness is, what justice is, what judgment is, what holiness is. The world don't know what righteousness is. If you don't believe me, get on Facebook. If you say amen, it'd be a good question to ask people on Facebook. I have a question. What is the righteousness of God? I wonder how many people will actually be able to answer that accurately according to the Bible. What is a demonstration of the righteousness of God in his people? Is it giving blood to the Red Cross? Is it having a Thanksgiving turkey dinner for the community? Is it giving clothes to the Salvation Army? What is a demonstration of the righteousness of God? Now, those are what is called good works. And the Bible says we should maintain good works. So we should do good works. But good works is not going to get anybody where? Into heaven. It's going to take the righteousness of God in order to get there. His righteousness. All right. Well, let's go to Malachi chapter 3. Preparing his throne for judgment. Working on us. Malachi chapter 3, verse 1 through 3. Last book of the Old Testament. All right. And if we have it, let's read. Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. Now, you know who that is? That's right, John the Baptist. That's very good. Y'all remember that. John the Baptist. Now, what's the scripture to prove that? Well, you can use Matthew 3. You can use Isaiah chapter 40. The voice of the one crying in the wilderness, make straight in the desert a highway for our God, just call Jesus God. Well, he said, I will send my messenger and he shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple. Now, he didn't say come into his temple. He said come to his temple. And that temple was his body. And that happened at the rivers of Jordan. Because that's not when God came into his body. He was in that body while it was yet in its mother's womb. Jesus was Christ the Lord even before he was born. But this is God coming to his temple as a visible manifestation of the Spirit to show John that he had baptized the right one. Because that's how John prepared the way for him, by baptizing and preaching repentance. Because he was told that when he began his ministry, that his ministry was for him to baptize the Messiah, manifesting him to Israel. So the Lord whom you seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of what? The covenant whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. Verse 2, but who may abide the day of his coming, and who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver. And he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver. Who is going to buy that? Who is going to stand up? Who's going to hold out during the refiner's fire? Because we know how they purify gold and silver. Is that right? Who's going to hold out? Who's going to withstand during that time? There's a lot of people that don't withstand the fire or the tests and trials that come their way. They burn up. They leave the church. They say, I don't have to take this anymore. I give up. But who may abide the day of his coming? Who shall stand when he appeareth? He shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the what? Sons of Levi. The church are the true-born sons of Levi. Levi means joined. God joined us to him when we were born again. All right? We've been joined unto him as far as ministry is concerned. All right? And purge them as gold and silver. Why? That they may offer unto the Lord an offering in what? And that offering we give him is our life. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable what? Service. People think they can just give God anything. They think they can go out there and live like a bunch of demons and then get up there and sing for Jesus. He's supposed to accept their offering. He's not accepting that offering. They can't even hold up against the fire. You can't purify gold if gold cannot withstand the fire. Gold is of the most precious metals that can withstand the heat. But the imperfections that's in the gold cannot withstand the heat. They are exposed. And then the refiner takes them off, or with a gavel, scrapes them off the top. The impurities come up to the top. And he, with a gavel, scrapes off that dross. And then he continues to turn that heat up, repeats that process 7 times. And at the 7th time, there's no more dross. He's able to look in there and see his perfect reflection. That is some pure gold. But see, when gold, when they first get it out of the mines, it don't look like that. You have to have a trained eye to see that it's even gold. It's all black and has all kinds of debris and stuff all over and everything. It doesn't look very pretty. But once the refiner gets done with that gold and with that silver, it is the most beautiful thing you can see. You can even look over and see your perfect reflection. That's what God's trying to do with us. Look at us to see his perfect what? Reflection. And that reflection, it would be the image of Jesus Christ. But we have to withstand the fire. Can we say amen? And that's how we will be able to offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. And this is what he's working on us for. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 to 13. Ephesians 4, 11 to 13. God's plan was to have a people in his own image, after his likeness. And we are being made into his spiritual image by the new birth. And we are being made after his likeness. Ephesians 4, 11 to 13. Let's read. And he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and what? Teachers. He gave these offices. These are the gifts he gave unto men. And why did he give us these offices? Verse 12, for the perfecting of the saints, or to prepare his throne for judgment. For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of what? That's why he put these offices there. Now, apostles, that job is closed. The last apostle to be called was Paul. The last one to live was John. And he died a natural death. And then you have prophets, which is an archaic term for the New Testament preachers. And then you have evangelists. A true evangelist is someone that takes the gospel where Christ has not been preached. Like Philip, it was called the evangelist, I think in the 26th chapter of Acts. Then you have pastors and teachers, or pastors who teach. And the highest office in the church today is pastor. The highest calling in the world. Somebody said, well, what about bishop? Well, a bishop is a pastor. It's one of the 18 titles of a pastor. Now, we do have some that are bishops that are over dioceses, which are states. We have a presiding bishop who presides over the whole organization. And these are organizational positions that have been established for the perpetuation of the order of God in the church. But to be called to the ministry is the highest call in the world, because even though they may be bishops, they are still pastors. We say amen, you know, and still call to the ministry. So organizationally, those offices are superior, but when you talk about a pastor, that is the highest office in the church today. It's higher than an evangelist. It's higher than just being a preacher, or like some like to call themselves today, prophets. You know, I don't know, they just don't understand what the office of a prophet is, because the prophets in the Old Testament times didn't have the Holy Ghost to abide with them forever. They only had the anointing to use them until God got finished using them, and then once he got finished using them, he took his anointing back. But a lot of these people don't really understand what a prophet really is. They think it's something above and beyond anything else. And they think it's all about just foretelling the future. Well, a prophet is one of the 18 titles of a pastor, because we foretell the future all the time. The Lord is coming. Can we say amen? That's a prophecy, isn't it? That's the greatest prophecy. Then in 3 days, you're going to get some new shoes or whatever. Or 3 days, your check going to be in the mail. Well, of course your check going to be in the mail. Your Social Security check come at the same time every month. Pastor, the Lord said your check's in the mail. Yes, on the 25th. That's when I get my retirement check every month. Can you be a little more specific? Can you tell me who's going to send it? Can you tell me how much it is? Well, yeah. So a lot of these guys, I think Brother Blaine was talking about how they went somewhere and the preacher prophesied to him that, what did he prophesy? That you're going to be hurt in the church, you're going to find another church that's going to help you or something. And he said, oh, no. He said, I'm not leaving my church. You talking about there's another church for me? Really? Well, he just went a little overboard there. He must have been feeling good at some point and prophesied some things that, and then kind of went overboard. But that's not just what a prophet is. The highest office in the ministry today is the pastor. All right. Well, some pastors and teachers, why did he put these positions there? Verse 12. For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the what? Edifying the body of Christ. Now, how long are we going to have these? Well, verse 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of what? Son of God. Now, that's not going to happen till the rapture. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, I would that there be no divisions among you, but that ye all speak the same thing. And that's kind of difficult because a lot of us come from different backgrounds. It's very difficult for all of us to speak the same thing, all of us preachers, all of us pastors. It is said that there's over 200 Jesus-only apostolic organizations in the world today. Over 200. Now, the Pentecostal Assemblies of the World was the first. The largest is the United Pentecostal Churches. I think last number I saw, they claimed to have something like 46,000 churches. And I think the PEW has maybe 5,000. So they are much, much larger than we are. But we're the original. We're the first. And all of the other ones that exist broke off had so many splits. But you just look at it, over 200 apostolic oneness organizations. Jesus' prayer in the 17th chapter of St. John was that they all may be what? And look what we have done. Isn't that something? Look what we have done. We've split off into 200. And of course, they all have different various beliefs. So that's why we try to encourage that we just fellowship on what we agree on. Baptism in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, being filled with the Holy Ghost, the evidence of speaking other tongues. Rapture of the church, living holy. Just focus on what we know. Now, of course, I saw that there is a gay apostolic organization. They are not apostolic. Can you say amen? You know, that's just a lie. They should just say gay people that are going to hell. That's the name of the organization ought to be. Not gay apostolic, because there is no such thing as a gay apostolic. You know, you just a bunch of backsliders. That's all you are. Well, they're going to get mad, but that's good. So we have these offices till we all come into what? Unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's where God is trying to get us to, and we will attain that status when the rapture takes place. We're caught up to meet the Lord in the air. Isn't that something? He would have finished the job that he was trying to do or is doing in us. Well, let's read on verse, I think we're done. All right, let's look at one more scripture, and then we're going to close for tonight. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 through 27. Ephesians 5, 25 to 27. Now, every place where it talks about the throne of God is not talking about the church. Not in every place. But where we've read is dealing with the church. Ephesians 5, 25 to 27. Let's read. Husbands, love your wives, even as what? Christ also loved the church and what? That's why the devil is trying to destroy the institution of marriage. Because the institution of marriage was designed to reflect Christ's love for his church. The devil does not want anything thriving that exemplifies the holiness of God. He wants to try to destroy any and everything. He doesn't want God acknowledged anywhere. He doesn't want people praying anywhere in schools. He doesn't want the word of God posted anywhere. He don't even want you to have a nativity scene out in your yard. That he'll have somebody come driving down your neighborhood and complain about a nativity scene in your yard. You know who that is? That's who? That's the devil. That's the devil. And so that's why he's got so-called gay marriage, so-called transgendered. Whatever God has started in the earth that is designed to give us a spiritual revelation of himself, the devil's trying to destroy that altogether. Well, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Why did he give himself for the church? Verse 26, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water, what? By the word. Why? That he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy. That's what God's trying to accomplish in us right now. Now, for every spiritual thing of God, there is a natural illustration of it somewhere. And the marriage is a natural illustration of the relationship concerning God and the church. And that's why the enemy is trying to destroy the institution of marriage. And that's why he tries to destroy us, because he does not want there to be anything in this world that will reflect the character and righteousness of God. So in the midst of all of that, we're fighting all of that, and God is still working on us that we might be what he called us to be, and we need to help him. Can we say amen? We need to help him. The difficulty and the trials we go through, just pray and ask God to give you grace to get through it, and that you get through it and that you get something out of it. That you know what God is doing with you. See, and if you get close to God enough, he'll let you know what he's trying to do in you by what you're going through. Because it's all good. Can we say amen? It's all for our betterment. Well, we're going to close tonight. Are there any questions we'll be covering tonight? Yes, Brother Ryan. Yes.
And then he can see his reflection.
Yes.
Can that relate to God's 7 days of creation of man, where he's taken him through that entire period, and then of course seven is his perfected number, or his complete number? Can that?
Well, you think God taking man through 7 days of creation?
No, through I know he started in 6 days.
Yes.
But it's a whole plan. I mean, with I guess you qualify like
Well, the whole plan of God of time is designed for him to get a people for himself. So if you're saying that, that's absolutely correct, because that's why he instituted time, because God was alone and he decided he didn't want to be alone by himself. He wanted a people that he could love that would love him. And so that's why he began time. And that's why he did all that. He already knew what would happen. He knew Adam would fail. He knew Lucifer would fall. He knew that things would be destroyed, but that was not going to deter him from getting what he wanted. So if you're speaking in that respect, that's absolutely correct. All right, anybody else tonight? All right, well, we will close. Thank you for your